one of the things I challenge councils is that if you've got a man with two kids, two daughters turning up to your council because he's a domestic violence victim, and you are unable to provide him with the same level of housing support than you would if a woman turned up with two sons 5 minutes later, then actually, you know, not only are you in breach of the Equality Act, but also, obviously, you're circumnavigating that whole issue around reversing agendas. So I think that's really important. The last one, and there's been a lot of debate about, you know, identity politics, and I think it's important to get away from this kind of narrative about this narrative and try and circumnavigate that by just saying that everyone should succeed, and we need recognition for men and boys' issues, but without negating the need to recognise women and girls' issues. And this is very much about being gender inclusive, not gender exclusive. So it's including all genders, and maybe different approaches and solutions to helping men and boys that are different to women and girls. But we've got to get past this whole issue around gender exclusivity, which is just about women and girls. And I think by using these types of phraseology will actually help. The last couple of slides is really about gendered issues. You hear a lot about people saying, well, this issue is a gendered issue, this issue is a woman and girls issue, this issue is a men and boys issue. But actually, the only gendered issues, I would say, were around certain health conditions, around, for example, pregnancy, or cervical cancer, prostate cancer, for example, which are very much innate to being a man or a woman. But I would say there's no gender issues, because if you talk about gender issues, what you end up doing is that you end up with the 6,000 people that commit suicide every year. You end up just talking about the men that commit suicide. Well, I'm concerned about the other 1,500 women who commit suicide as much as the men who do. And it's the same when I go back to that Campbell Peckham question. If you just talk about the number of women on 1,500 boardrooms, you're then ignoring the need to actually get more working class kids back in Campbell and more working class boys to have them, you know, the same opportunities to get onto the 1,500 boards. So when you hear about people talk about gendered issues, I think the phrase "this is a gendered issue" is now old fashioned. I don't think that has relevance now in terms of actually making sure we have equality for women and girls and men and boys. And I think talking about an issue being gendered just perpetuates that narrative that I've spoken about, and actually just perpetuates that silence. Right, we've got one more, and this is really where we want to get to. There's no gendered issues. Think back to that chart idea. So all of those issues, they all fit, if you like, one big narrative, and there aren't any gendered issues anymore. They're just issues. And that is where I think we need to get to in terms of politics, how we need to end the silence on men and women's issues. Thank you. Gender exclusivity, or this mono gender, I prefer gender exclusivity, what I'm saying is that I'm railing against the lack of public policy in government. So the government and others, part of this grand narrative I mentioned, is saying that issues are gendered and are gender exclusive. But what I'm saying is to tackle that, we've got to talk about them not being gendered, and we've got to talk about them being gender inclusive.
But they are gendered. We have widespread male genital mutilation. Yeah. We do not have widespread female genital mutilation. So the idea that we can't look at this through a gender lens, I think is just astonishing.
Well, yeah, but I'm trying to move the story on. I mean, because if we start trading, I come back to this issue, if we start trading issues, because...
there are no issues to trade.
But the thing is, if you look at women and the Women's Equality Party, they will have 20 manifesto issues.
They don't.
Yeah,
the leader and the party spokesman of that party, but both of them have won two Mari Feminist Month Awards. There are no issues which are specifically female today in Britain, other than manufactured ones.
Yeah, but I'll come back to that. But what I'm saying is that White or Westminster are saying that every issue is a gendered issue. What I'm saying is that means that men and boys' issues are being squeezed out of public policy and are not being supported, not being dealt with. But is the answer just to then capture a load of issues for ourselves and say, well, these are our gendered issues?
So that's been so
what you end up doing is that you just end up fighting. What I'm trying to suggest is the way around this is just circumnavigating the whole thing.
Okay, and I think this debate could go on because they are two different positions. I think we're talking about achieving the same sort of goal from two different angles. Yes, Vincent.
Thanks, John. I strongly with you, Mark, and an extremely informative lecture as it was at Bedford as well from you. In 2014, I managed to get twice to the Petitions Commission of the European Parliament based on now five Ombudsman's investigations, particularly with contact orders and family courts. That's my specialty. And in the three MEPs I was chatting to afterwards, two of which were female, I was absolutely struck how they considered the UK, I'm not commenting on Ireland, how they considered the UK to be in the absolute dark ages and on this entire family systems, gender issues and all the rest. The thing is stuck in the 1970s time warp. It's as if it's looked upon as being sort of embarrassed black sheep in Europe. I was totally staggered by that, because I expected to meet hostility from the MEPs, the parliament, the female ones. Quite the opposite. So, you know, if we could ever, the issue you are raising, could ever get a bigger audience off the ground a bit, it's not, in this country perhaps you'll get support, it's internationally. Because here it's too squashed. There is too much control.
You can imagine what their views will be if we left the European Union. Anyway.
Thank you.
Hi. Just want to sort of preface like what I want to say with the fact that I'm a clinical psychologist and I'm training here at UCL. So I work quite a lot with men, and I'm pretty aware of men's issues, particularly around sort of suicide and mental health, and I completely agree that they are very much pushed under the carpet and they need to be brought to the forefront. I'm also doing my research thesis on sexual violence against men, and how underreported it is in refugees, and like the reasons why, both personal and interpersonal barriers as to why men don't disclose sexual violence. So I completely agree. And I would love it if we could kind of get to this point, but I feel like kind of the point that you've missed here is maybe acknowledging the reasons why there are a lot of services that are built for women and like LGBT and sort of minority people is because they have been systematically oppressed. And kind of what you're saying is almost that heterosexual men are somehow this kind of oppressed minority, which I don't really feel like they are, even though there are definite issues that face them and need to be talked about, and I see them and work with them every single day. But it kind of, I feel like this is a systemic issue. And so rather than kind of attacking women and girls and the fact that these parties and things exist because they need to, because women have systematically always been treated worse than men, and minorities have been as well, we need to kind of acknowledge.
Well, I mean the one thing about the whole issue around gender politics and everything, and political correctness and everything, is it groups people into particular boxes.
But there's a history behind those boxes. They haven't just magically appeared, you know? Like, there's a history of some systematic oppression against women and minorities, which is why these things have had to be built. I mean, no, it's fine, I'm going to leave after this anyway, so don't worry. But that we need to acknowledge the reason.
Part of the conversation.
No, of course. No, I'm trying.
Yeah,
but
no,
No, I appreciate that, but it's just that there's a history that we need to acknowledge there. And obviously, yeah, because I'm working with men's and boys' issues.
But the issue is this about putting people into boxes because of their skin colour, their sexuality, or their gender? Is that more important than actually dealing with people who have problems based on their own individual need? So, you know, come back to the law and everything. The law and the British Constitution, everything is about individual. You know, it doesn't matter what your colour is, sexuality, race, etc. It doesn't matter. And so the issue isn't around identity politics. We want to get past that. It's actually about looking at the person first as an individual. Now, I can't, you know, I would dispute that every, and I come back to the grand narrative, you know, women may have ended up being discriminated against, but not every woman. Not every woman. Not every man is part of the patriarchy. Not every man sits on FTSE 100 board. You know, for every man who sits on FTSE 100 board, there'd be a guy around the corner sleeping rough. So this is about people and individuals. This isn't about putting people into politically correct tea boxes.
Thank you. And can I just say, thank you so much for that question.
Yeah,
I think you can see that there's a lot of people here that don't agree with you. But if you, probably you'll get kind of further explanations if you stick around afterwards. Some of us are going to go for a drink. I hope you can join us. In fact, we've got a table at the TCR bar. And we've also got a table at the Jeremy Bentham. So we have support for choices of boxers. Just stick around and listen to lots of the guys at this time. Yes, this gentleman here.
It strikes me that policy ought to recognise gender differences because they are vast. You only have to see a primary school playground to see the boys tearing around like fighter pilots and the girls sitting chatting. During Chimera, a world expert in sex differences, wrote a book called Sex and Commission, and she found that in mathematics as opposed to arithmetic, men outperform women by one standard error, which means that there are three times as many men in the top 2% of mathematical ability as there are women. She also found that men outperform women in three-dimensional imaginary rotation by one standard error, which is a critical thing for engineering, which means only one woman in six is as good as the average man in that, which is why so many women turn maps upside down in the medium. There are massive differences between the genders, but to pretend they don't exist seems to be bound to lead to very poor policies and a ridiculous expectation of equal outcomes. You can't expect equal outcomes if people are different to start with.
Okay, so, Eli.
I thought I would link what some of what the speakers have said, and I think maybe for me there's something to be learned here from the gay movement, actually, and that is that gay people became an entity only when they could be named and identified, and then there could be work done in order to give gay people equal rights, such as marriage eventually. But unless they're identified as a group that can be engaged with, it's very difficult to see what their needs are and to form equality. And I think for me, what has happened with some privilege that men do have because of patriarchy is the cost that they have, the oppression that they also suffer as part of patriarchy, means that they become the norm, so therefore the uninvestigated. So men don't really exist, we just are the norm. And so the particular difficulties that men have cannot be seen. I think quite different to what you say. We first have to identify men as a group, as a political group that needs inquiry about, and then we can move on to, and how do we balance this out to form equality?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I don't disagree, because again, you know, the women and girls narrative on that is not going to go away. So you almost have to go through two stages. You have to recognise that the men and boys have particular issues that have not been addressed, even if those issues in some respects are the same as women. You know, for example, eating disorders, they've been very much a female-focused problem, but now more men are being recognised as suffering from that as well. So that needs to be on the agenda, certainly. But does that mean that eating disorders is an issue that's captured just for women, or is that an issue for just men and boys?
If I can just respond to that, I think yes, because eating disorders for men manifest very differently than for women, you know. In the same way that, for instance, I'm a clinical psychologist, and the way that a man would express his depression would be very different than the way that a woman would. And so when we talk about these things, the same, if you talk about women being victims of sexual offending, the way that they report it, the way that they experience might be very different than men. Men might not even realize that they're being abused. So we can't just have one norm to measure it. We have to have norms and measuring that's sensitive to the genders.
Yeah, well, I suppose what I'm saying is, is that the issues aren't necessarily gendered. The approaches to helping different people who suffer from that, those issues can be gendered. I mean, again, if you look at domestic abuse, I mean, you know, domestic abuse is similar. You know, some men have different issues than women. But if you have a gender exclusivity, which is what we've got now, it's only the issues around women and girls that are looked at, but not men and boys. If you talk about male victims of domestic abuse, then what that means is that we're talking about domestic abuse as an issue, but actually we can have a different approach to actually helping those particular men. But the issue itself is just about domestic abuse. The problem is that the issues now captured and just about, they're all women and girls issues. Different approaches, fine, issues. Does that make sense?
I'd just like to respond. There seems to me a real inherent contradiction in what I just said there. If you talk about the idea that we talk about patriarchy as a fact, it's a theory, not a fact, which I would fundamentally contest. Second of all, I would contest the meaning of what patriarchy means and how it affects people. But that an aside, the fundamental inconsistency within the argument is you're saying that men and boys, as a consequence of patriarchy, are the invisible group because they are the norm. But the idea of patriarchy prevents, because it creates men as oppressive group, it prevents people talking about men and boys as having disadvantage.
That's my point exactly.
Is that your point?
That's exactly my point.
And that means you don't believe in patriarchy then?
No, but this is the point, is that men become invisible because of the system. So
if you're talking about a system which creates privilege for men and boys, how can you then be invisible within it and disadvantage as a consequence of it?
Because privilege has two sides. Privilege always has two sides.
It comes with cost. So as a gay man,
privilege always comes with cost.